Hello everyone, today I'm going to talk about how I managed to make this final project of a backpack that causes a splatter of paint on a wall and it paints the wall. So to get started, I try to find that perfect spot in my footage where I could see that the backpack was directly hitting the wall. And after I did that, I duplicated the layer, clicked into it so I could begin rotoscoping. And to rotoscope, you just use that green tool, mark the places you want, mark the places you don't. And then you can hit Alt W to make the edges rounder, smoother for the final product. Once I hit page down a few times and I just felt comfortable with how the rotoscope was turning out, I then froze all the layers of the rotoscope I did, and then I just reviewed what it looked like with a solid background, and I was pretty happy with it. So the next thing I did was I added this PNG image of like a paint smear, and I put a tint on it so that it could match the background of the backpack. So I wanted to rotate it and just make sure that when the backpack was hitting the wall and falling, that it looked like it was leaving some sort of paint smear on the wall. But in order to make it completely disappear behind the backpack, I added a new solid and just created a rectangular shape, and by using the vertical position keyframes, I followed the backpack so that it would hide anything below the smear before it got there. But the key here is to make sure that you alpha invert the brush layer, that smear layer, so that it hides that part of the backpack as it falls. Now my computer didn't want me to record this part, I guess, but here I'm going layer, new, shape layer, making sure that the fill is transparent and making the stroke color the same as the backpack with a point size of 100. I then use the pen tool to draw a line that will act as the first splatter that we're gonna create. Here I'm just adjusting my timeline to make sure that we can view everything as we start to create these drop looking splatters. Here I went into the contents of the layer and started messing with the length and the ease, the start and end length and ease, to make it look like a droplet. Then the amount of the wave and the wavelength really made it start to look like a splatter effect. But I wasn't completely happy yet, so I added a roughen edges, and then here you can see that it really starts to make it look more wavy. And for animation of the splatter, under add and then trim paths, I found this to be really effective in animating what I wanted to do to create the splatter. So I set keyframes on the start and end to 100% and then pushed over a certain amount to grow that droplet outward so that it pops out. And I liked how this was looking, but I didn't exactly like the width and the size of the droplet. So that's where up here at stroke width, you can adjust that with keyframes as well. And of course I had to use the keyframe assistant to make everything easy in, just make it look smoother. I then adjusted the curve of the actual droplet to make it look more natural, and so that I could then duplicate those droplets and then manipulate them in different ways to make them have different shapes. And that's where that animation feature, that trim paths, comes in handy with the start and end features, because they can make the droplet look shorter, they can make it look wider with the stroke width. So there's lots of different things that you can do to make each droplet look different. Now the rendering on my laptop in real time is not the best, but I then adjusted each of the different splats so that they looked like they were coming out at different times, which is more natural for what a splat would do. The last thing I wanted to add to this paint splatter effect involves a new solid in which I use the ellipse tool to create a nice shape that I can then expand and just take up the whole page like the backpack splattered and took up everything. I added another turbulent displace effect because I knew it would give me that classic, even Nickelodeon looking splatter. I then adjusted the mask expansion keyframes so that it would completely fill up the screen while keeping its funky shape. I also changed the opacity so that it would fade in from light and fade out to dark. And then I also just duplicated that layer and added the same effect to the beginning, but just reversed. And since it's reversed, that means after I finished rendering it, I could make it be like a continuous loop. So here's how it turned out. Want a million sugar high. Want a million sugar strawberries on a summer evening.